With the climate change emergency in full effect, the world is in need of a hero. And while we typically think of heroes as being big, brash and strong, what if our hero in this particular situation happened to be the smallest and most abundant element in the universe? Is it ironic that our potential global warming hero makes up over 90% of the very thing that heats the planet up? Let's take a closer look at why there's so much hype around
hydrogen.
Hydrogen
makes up over 75% of the universe and is the most abundant element in it. And although it's the third most common element on Earth, it's what is known as a clingy gas. On Earth, hydrogen is typically found attached to other elements, most commonly in water, or H2O, which is two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom, and in hydrocarbons, such as methane, which is also known as natural gas. Pure hydrogen is rare in the Earth's atmosphere because it's so small and light, it can actually escape gravity and bleed through the Earth's atmosphere and into space. So, if you want to access hydrogen to, you know, save the planet, you need to split hydrogen off from whatever it's sticking to. And one simple way of doing this with water is called electrolysis. To do this, all you need to do is put some baking soda into water to help with conductivity, and then pass a current, in this case from a battery, through the solution. You'll start to see bubbles forming on the exposed ends of the cables in the water. And this is water splitting into hydrogen and oxygen. And as water is H2O, you get twice as many hydrogen atoms as you do oxygen atoms. Once you've separated the hydrogen, there are two ways scientists are looking to harness its energy. First of all, hydrogen is flammable, so you can just burn it like other fuel sources. But burning hydrogen doesn't screw with the environment like burning other fuel sources does. But more on that later. Secondly, it can be used to power a fuel cell. Fuel cells kind of work like batteries. They run on hydrogen and oxygen and react to supply electricity. They can be used to power vehicles, boats, aeroplanes, and those sorts of things. Now, fuel cells are not a new technology. In fact, they were invented in the 1800s. And in the 1890s, a scientist in Denmark named Paul Lecour used windmills to power electrolysis and supply hydrogen as an energy source for gas lamps. And in the 1960s, General Motors built a car powered by hydrogen fuel cells. Right now, though, hydrogen is primarily used to make other things, like fertilizer and petroleum, but it has never been made as a standalone fuel source. And that's because it's always been easier and cheaper to burn fossil fuels. In fact, fossil fuels are hydrocarbons. They're compounds made up of only two elements, hydrogen and carbon. But all of that's changing with climate change. With countries and companies committing to net zero carbon emissions, the smallest and most abundant element in the universe could be the key to solving the world's most complex problem. To break this down a bit, we're going to compare hydrogen to methane, more commonly referred to as natural gas. In order to achieve the same combustion, you need three things. A fuel source, which in this instance is butane, oxygen, which comes from the air surrounding the lighter, and an ignition source. Now, natural gas or methane is a hydrocarbon, which means it's made up of hydrogen and carbon. And the chemical formula for methane is CH4, which means there's one carbon atom and four hydrogen atoms, making up one methane compound molecule. When this is ignited and achieves complete combustion, the carbon and hydrogen are split apart and form bonds with the oxygen molecules, resulting in byproducts of one CO2 compound being carbon dioxide and two H2O compounds being water vapor. Now the issue here is that carbon dioxide is released into the atmosphere, contributing to climate change. Conversely, when pure hydrogen is used, there is no carbon present in the combustion process to form carbon dioxide. So the only byproduct of combustion is H2O, or water, which is in a vapor form. All of this sounds too good to be true. And if it was really this easy, why aren't we doing it already? And this comes all the way back to hydrogen being a sticky element. To get access to it, we need to release it from its sticky buddy oxygen. But how? Kind of ironic, right? We need to separate the hydrogen from oxygen in order to be able to burn it for it to bond back together with the oxygen again. Now here's where it gets tricky. Not all hydrogen is created equally. In fact, there's a whole rainbow of different ways to get pure hydrogen. First of all, you have brown or black hydrogen, and this uses the gasification of coal to create pure hydrogen, but carbon monoxide is also a byproduct of this process. Next, you have grey hydrogen, which uses methane in a process called steam methane reforming, where it is heated up with steam and a catalyst, and it primarily produces hydrogen and carbon monoxide, Again, carbon is what we're trying to avoid in this process. The next level of hydrogen separation is called turquoise hydrogen, which is derived through a thermal process known as methane pyrolysis, which involves methane being passed through a molten metal, and it results in hydrogen and carbon being extracted. However, the carbon that is released in this process actually becomes solid. So at the end of this, you still have carbon to deal with. It's just in a solid form. Then you have blue hydrogen, which uses the same process as grey hydrogen, which is steam methane reforming, but uses carbon capture to prevent the carbon being released to atmosphere. You then have pink hydrogen, which uses nuclear power to fuel the electrolysis process. And last, and possibly the most important, is green hydrogen, which uses clean renewable energy generated by wind and solar to power the electrolysis process. So what you can see here is that just having access to hydrogen won't help fight climate change. In fact, there's research out there suggesting that if it's not green hydrogen, it would be more environmentally friendly to burn the fossil fuel directly than to use the fossil fuel to create hydrogen. And at the moment, 90% of hydrogen produced is grey hydrogen, which is made from fossil fuels, mainly methane. So what's currently powering our lifeblood to a sustainable future is one of the very things we're trying to remove our dependence on. To have planet-saving hydrogen, we need to clean up how it's produced. Which brings us to blue hydrogen, which uses the same process as grey hydrogen, but uses carbon capture to prevent the carbon being released to atmosphere. And that sounds great, right? And it would be if it worked. US Professor Robert Howarth released a study identifying that the greenhouse gas of blue hydrogen is worse than if you burned the methane used to make it. Now, despite this reality, blue hydrogen is in the long-term strategies of most major economies, including the US, the UK, Japan, and the EU. Now, this could be due to the lobbying powers of major oil companies, as they are well placed to create blue hydrogen within their current processes. Now, enter green hydrogen. Green hydrogen uses clean renewable energy generated by wind and solar to power electrolysis on a large scale. This produces no emissions, so you end up with true clean hydrogen. But right now, you'll be hard-pressed to come by green hydrogen, as it's still really expensive to make. But with the investment being made into hydrogen and electrolysis by governments and private equity firms, mass manufacturing plants are starting to become reality. Additionally, the cost to create renewable energy is also coming down, which further aids green hydrogen's cause. Estimates are that by 2030, green hydrogen will be cheaper to make than blue hydrogen and cheaper than grey hydrogen by 2050. So, climate crisis solved, right? Not quite. Hydrogen's energy density is about one third of methane, so you need 3 times more hydrogen to do the same job. And so infrastructure remains the biggest barrier to any colour of hydrogen being used. Most countries have electrical and fossil fuel networks, and the cost to add a third network for centrally produced hydrogen will be expensive. Providing more localised production stations could be an option, and there are small-scale trials being run at gas stations around the world, with 53 stations currently offering hydrogen in California. This change could also mean using refillable hydrogen bottles to replace natural gas and LPG in residential applications. But this would require current gas appliances to be replaced with those specifically designed for hydrogen. And while hydrogen appliances are coming onto the market, there is a bit of a chicken and egg scenario playing out. On top of this, it takes about 48 kilowatts of electrical input to create about 33 kilowatts of hydrogen energy. And that means that the electrolysis process is about 69% efficient. So if we lose this much energy in the process to create green hydrogen, why not just forget it and use renewable energy directly as electricity? So the answer to this is a little bit complicated, but let's try to simplify it here. So the first thing to consider is that when you're using renewable energy sources to generate electricity, you can only do so while the energy source is available. The sun needs to be shining for solar panels and the wind needs to be blowing for wind turbines, unlike unrenewables, which can be used to generate electricity at any time. So in order to compensate for this reality, we need to be able to store the renewable energy while we can generate it, in order to be able to use that stored energy when the renewable energy source isn't available to generate more electricity. And while the storage component of a renewable energy system is referred to as a battery, in this instance, it simply means a storer of energy, not a battery like the one on your phone. There are many forms of batteries in this regard, including pumped hydro, compressed air, batteries in the traditional sense, flywheels, thermal storage, and of course, hydrogen. Now, for the purposes of this video, we're not going to get into the details of the others. The key thing to understand here is that hydrogen is one of these options, and there's good reason to want to generate hydrogen in the first place, even for our electrical grid. On top of that, it could be more important for the transport industries than EVs, as hydrogen fuel cells have a much longer range and faster refuel time than electric batteries, making them more practical for long distance travel and for heavier vehicles like trucks. Electric batteries also require lithium and cobalt to be made, both of which are natural minerals mined out of the ground. In fact, the largest auto manufacturer in the world has recently come under fire for its lack of progression on electric vehicles, as it's placed a massive bet on hydrogen being the fuel source of the future. So then, with so many different ways of using hydrogen, where do we begin? One way to look at this is by considering the CO2 output of different energy sources. To do this, we need to be a little bit more specific. So let's consider New Zealand, and then we'll look at the US. In New Zealand, around 50% of emissions come from agriculture and the other 50 from energy consumption. Of that 50%, 32% is oil, 33% is renewable via electricity and other uses, 21% is from natural gas and LPG, which both have roughly the same CO2 emissions, 6.7% is wood, and 7.1% is from coal. Now, when you compare those energy uses to the US, 36% is oil, 12% is renewable via electricity or other uses, 32% is natural gas, 8% is nuclear, and 11% is coal. Now, when you consider that natural gas emits around 0.2 kilograms of CO2 per kilowatt hour, petrol is around 1 kilogram of CO2 per kilowatt hour, wood emits around 0.5 kilograms of CO2 per kilowatt hour, and coal emits around 1 kilogram of CO2 per kilowatt hour, it's important that we note that these values can change depending on a number of variables. For the wood example, if you use regenerative forestry, the net carbon value for burning wood decreases as the growing trees absorb carbon. But for argument's sake, these are the values that we're going to use for comparison. Now, when you look at these values next to each other, it's easy to see that if hydrogen was used to replace one of these energy sources, oil and coal would be the first targets, as they have much higher CO2 emission values than natural gas, and we consume a lot more energy from oil than we do from natural gas. And this makes it very clear, hydrogen fuel cells and EVs are the future, as we need to reduce the amount of oil being consumed as energy. But hey, we're here now, so let's muddy the water some more. In order for us to move off of oil and provide hydrogen for fuel cells and renewable electricity for electric vehicles, we need to double our renewable energy output. And if we wanted to replace natural gas, wood, and coal as well, we'd need to triple it. And on top of that, and this is pretty crazy, it's cleaner to burn methane than it is to release it into the atmosphere unburnt. Methane released into the atmosphere has a short-term climate change effect 80 times greater than that of CO2. Now, through the extraction process and piped infrastructure to get natural gas to its point of use, methane is leaked into the atmosphere, which means reducing our reliance on methane in the short term could actually make it a higher priority than reducing oil consumption. But at the moment, if we go back to the hydrogen rainbow, grey hydrogen is the most common form of hydrogen generation, and grey hydrogen relies on, you guessed it, methane to be produced. And with 70% efficiency, you need to consume around 1.4 times as much methane to produce the same amount of hydrogen energy. So stick around for the next video where we take a closer look at what the introduction for hydrogen as a replacement for methane as a fuel source means for the gas-fitting industry.